Welcome to the Omnibus Show, a programme for people who are interested in everything, with deep conversations on a wide variety of subjects. And now your host, Dave Gibbs.
Hello, and welcome to this episode of the Omnibus Show, the programme for people who are interested in everything, with deep conversations on a wide variety of subjects. This episode's guest is Frank Basile. Frank is one of Indiana's premier philanthropists, and he's a native of New Orleans. After a 33-year career for the Gene Glick Company, where he was senior vice president, he has been a philanthropist, and he served on many boards, 11 non-for-profits, and is on the board of three, Fonseca, the Center for Performing Arts, and the Heartland Film Festival. He's also served as interim CEO and president of the Center for Performing Arts here in Carmel, and as interim president of the Heartland Film Festival. He has presented over 1,400 speeches, written 13 books, and has authored more than 1,500 articles. He's also received the Bicentennial and Spirit of Philanthropy Award, along with his wife, Katrina, from Indiana University for his philanthropy. That's a lot, Frank. Great to have you here with us today.
Good to be here, Dave. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you so much. And, wow, that's a big mountain of things. So, but just starting off, it's just really good to have you here, and welcome. We'll go right into it.
Okay.
What sparked your interest in philanthropy?
Frankly, you mentioned I was from New Orleans. Well, actually, that's where it started.
Okay.
Because growing up, my family did not have much money, and certainly not enough to send my five sisters and me to arts events. Mm-hmm. In fact, arts wasn't even on their radar at that time.
Okay.
So it was not until I was in college at Tulane that I attended my first arts event. And it was a play put on by the drama department, and the admittance was free, so I
that's
went.
That's always a good prize.
Right, that's right. And I have to tell you, it was love at first sight. I absolutely enjoyed it, and I went to as many free arts events as I could while I was in college, and that's when I realized that arts add so much to the quality of life and how important it is. And I can remember at the time thinking to myself, it's a shame that there are kids who can't attend arts events for whatever reason, lack of funds or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I remembered thinking at the time that if I could ever be in a position where I could help kids to attend events, I would do so and to make it possible for them so that they would not be deprived of the opportunity. But fortunately, a lot of schools do provide arts training and so on, but those in New Orleans at the time did not.
Mm-hmm.
So that really began my philanthropy, or my interest in philanthropy, let me put it that way. And it later was incorporated into what became my personal mission, and that is to help marginalized people. By that I mean people because marginalized because of income, race, sexual orientation, or whatever, to help them reach their potential. Mm-hmm. And I started doing that in the early years through my motivational speaking and workshops, and through my writing of articles and books. And then later on, when I didn't do much of the speaking and the writing, it was through participation in not-for-profit organizations,
mm-hmm.
and also my philanthropy. So that's basically how my interest in philanthropy first started.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's fascinating. And then you worked with Gene Glick,
yes,
who is a very well, he and his wife, very well-known philanthropist. And how was that influence on you?
Well, it goes into, to begin with, I had the opportunity working for Gene Glick, who was not only my boss for 33 years, but also my mentor. In the last few years that I worked there, he involved me with his philanthropy. And he asked me to check out, to do some due diligence on requests that were made
mm-hmm.
For like funds and so on and so forth, which I did. And then he told me about the factors that he considers when he's making philanthropic decisions, which was very, very helpful. And that was probably the first. The second was Henry Ryder, who was an attorney. And one day he called me when I was at the Glick office, and he said, "Frank, I have a favor to ask of you." He was a friend, and I liked him a lot, and said, "Sure, anything." And he said, "Would you consider chairing the operating fund campaign for the Indianapolis Art League," which is what the Art Center was called at that time? Mm-hmm. Well, I have to tell you, there was about a few seconds of silence, and I said, "Henry, I don't know what an operating fund campaign is. And also, I don't know what the Art League is." And of course, that should have ended the conversation.
Sure.
But it didn't. Henry said, "Well, look, after work this evening, why don't you drive to Broad Ripple, and this is the address where the Art League is located, and ask for Joyce Summers, who runs the place." I said, "Okay." So I did. And lo and behold, Joyce was so impressive and communicated so well the value of the arts, of the Art League at the time, and arts in general, that I ended up chairing that campaign and learning as I went along what to do. And then a year or so later, I even joined a board.
Wow.
And so, and that was my first not-for-profit experience, but it was so good. I enjoyed it so much, and it was so valuable to me that I joined a couple of other boards when I was still working at the Glick Company.
Sure.
And it became an avocational interest of mine, participation on boards. And then later on, when I retired, it became my main activity.
You
know how normal people, you know, golf and so on when they retire? Well, I went on not-for-profit boards.
There you go.
But that's what I did. But anyway, that also led directly into my philanthropy, being involved with Joyce Summers in the Art League, because one day after a board meeting, I recall she invited me into her office. And she said, she began the conversation with asking why I was involved with the Art Center, with the Art League, which I thought was a strange question given how I first became involved, you know, not knowing anything about it. And I said, "I love the outreach. I like the fact that you make art available to people who couldn't otherwise afford to do so. Mm-hmm. Even entry is free into the Art Center," and so on and so forth. And I said, and that ties in with my personal mission of helping others who are perhaps marginalized. And she said, "I'm really glad to hear you say that, because we're getting ready to build a Michael Graves building, and the main reason is to enhance the outreach program." And right then, I thought that I have given her the way to ask me for a donation.
And show, of course, me your wallet,
yeah,
son.
good fundraisers, like good salespeople, always ask questions, and they listen, and then they know how to present whatever it is that they're selling. Mm-hmm. So, cut a long story short, I made my first contribution of more than $1,000 or so, because I'd always been afraid that I would run out of money since I had grown up very poor. But I felt an immediate sense of satisfaction when I made that decision. And about a month later, she calls me into her office again. And being a very fast learner, I said, "Look, Joyce, I don't have any more money." She said, "No, I'm not asking you for any money." She showed me the plans for the new building. And she said, "Because of what you have contributed, you can name something in the building." I said, "What do you mean, name?" She said, "It's a new thing that not-for-profits are doing, where they're naming things for people who make donations depending upon how much they donate." I said, "That's kind of weird." She said, "But that's what they're doing." She said, "For example, a Joe Blow hallway might be something that might be named." So she said, "But anyway, but for the amount of your contribution, you could name three or four things, and one was the gift shop. And I enjoy shopping, and when I go to a museum, I always enjoy going into the gift shop so I can take home a piece of the museum.
Sure.
Without stealing it. So I decided to name that. Okay, so 2 years later, serving on the board, enjoying my service, and so on and so forth, she calls me into her office again. And she says, you know, we love this building, but making this mortgage payment is really hampering our operating funds. And if somehow we could pay off the balance of the loan for the building, it would really help us a lot. And she said, would you consider doing that? And again, I thought about it and decided I would do it. And so she came back in the next week and she said, for this amount, now you can name something else, and one of which was the auditorium. Mm. And being a speaker and liking plays, I decided that would be a great thing to do. So anyway, we named the auditorium, and that began our little string of gift shops and theaters, because whenever a not-for-profit would ask what we wanted to name in response to a gift, mm-hmm. we would say either, you know, one or the other, and so on. But that always was a secondary reason for giving and had nothing to do with the main. The main reason was we were always interested in the mission of the organization and its vision in what we were contributing. But in any event, that was the beginning of my philanthropic experience, thanks to both Henry Ryder for getting me involved in the organization and to Joyce Summers for taking me along the road toward philanthropy. And frankly, it has been one of the most satisfying experiences of my life, both the not-for-profit board experience as well as the philanthropy.
Well, that's it for Chapter 1 with Frank Basile. We'll be back after a brief break for Chapter 2 on the Omnibus Show.
So don't let them be. Sleep like the dead desire I only remember when they begin the begin.
Well, hello and welcome back to Chapter 2. Our interview today is with Frank Basile. Frank, it's great having you with us, and I'd like to now pivot towards your philosophy of philanthropy, and I will hand it to you. Please tell us about that.
Frankly, Dave, I really believe that any success or happiness we achieve in this life is a byproduct of the service we render to other human beings. Mm-hmm. And I think that service can come in terms of volunteer work, giving of money, and so on. But I believe that service is the only rent we pay for the space we occupy on this planet, and that's why it gives me pleasure to be able to help others, as I said, in my personal mission, to help others to achieve their potential, particularly those who are marginalized. And I think back on a talk that Albert Schweitzer had given, and he said, I don't know what your destinies will be, but this I know, those of you who will be truly happy are those who will have sought and found how to serve. And interestingly enough, along the lines of philosophy of philanthropy, last night I was reading the Sunday paper, and I noticed an article on philanthropy. Mm-hmm. And being a philanthropist, I should have probably already known this, but you know how the word started, philanthropy?
I know a bit of Greek, but I know philo being love and anthropos being people.
My God, you know. Okay, that's exactly what it was.
Okay.
In the 5th century, a Greek playwright of all, a Greek playwright coined the word that became philanthropy. And its definition at that time was love of mankind, love of humanity.
That's a noble phrase.
Yeah. And so that prompted me to look up the definition. After all of these years of being a philanthropist, I decided to look at a dictionary and find out what the definition of it was. And it was someone who gives of his time, talent, and treasure to help other people live a better life, which makes sense to me. But yeah. In any event, that's kind of my philosophy of philanthropy. Thank you for asking.
Yeah, that's a very noble ideal. It's really the heart of that definition of love of mankind, and very noble one. We certainly need more of that. You had talked about those individuals who helped you get into philanthropic projects. Are there some more projects that you would like to tell us about? Because you've been involved with many, many broad variety of projects.
You know, one of the first was that Brian Fonseca contacted me about making a lead gift and chairing a campaign for a church that he wanted, a church building he wanted to buy to convert into a theater. And I agreed to do so because I enjoyed attending the plays at the Phoenix. They were cutting-edge plays, and they, in fact, they practiced diversity, equity, and inclusion, which has since become popular, but in those days it wasn't. And he addressed the AIDS issue and other issues long before it became general knowledge and discussed, particularly in Indianapolis at the time. And so I agreed to do that, and the converted church became the theater. Well, about a year later, I get a phone call from him, and he says that he had phone calls from three companies that had sponsored his season, and they were withdrawing a sponsorship. And he said, and this is devastating to us, because these are three of our five main sponsors. And I said, why? And he said, because they don't like the play that I'm putting on now. And it had some nudity and some reference to gays and so on. And again, putting it back in the early 1980s, Indianapolis was rather conservative. It isn't as liberal as it is now. And at that time, I didn't have enough money to make up that difference to help him, but there was something I could do. Because at the time, I was writing a weekly column for the Indianapolis Business Journal. So the following week, I wrote an article about this. And I said, you know, it's a shame that alternative theater is not acceptable here in Indianapolis, and we want to become a world-class city. Well, this is impossible now. So, you know, you get the idea of the article. And I mentioned the withdrawal of the funding for the Phoenix Theater. Well, I have to tell you, it's the first time in my life I got hate mail. However, enough people responded so that he made up for the difference that he lost in those three who had withdrawn in order to continue the production. And he told me, he said, I'm not about to change the nature of the plays that I put on to satisfy these people, because this is what I'm into, this is what I believe in, and God bless him for doing that. In any event, so that was one that I was involved in early on. Another activity was Pauline Moffitt, who was the executive director of Indie Fringe, contacted me and said, we have an opportunity to buy an old church on Mass Avenue and College, which is perfect for us, at a very reasonable price. But the owner said he's going to put it on the open market in 2 weeks and gave us 2 weeks to tell him whether we're going to buy it or not. And I ended up agreeing to do so because it fit my mission, because small performing arts groups at that time did not have a place to perform other than at Indie Fringe. And the annual Fringe Festival allows these small groups to perform who otherwise would not have a place to do it. So this helped the arts. And we did that, and it was, again, one of the most satisfying things that I'd ever done was to enable Indie Fringe to operate out of their own building. and many others. I don't know how time is on this, but many other examples I could give you, but we can...
What is the current project that you'd be working on?
Okay.
That people are working on?
Actually, it's back to Fonseca. It's the Fonseca Theater.
Okay.
That he established about 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And based, again, upon diversity, equity, and inclusion.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, he passed away due to COVID a couple of years after he founded the theater. But it's been carrying on by someone who had assisted him in his last days. And we recently fulfilled a vision that he had of opening up a collaboration center in the building next to the theater in order to allow people in the neighborhood to come in, to congregate, to have kids' classes, and in general, make it available because it's all located in Hawville. And one of his goals was to help the Hawville and surrounding West Side, near West Side communities to survive and thrive.
Mm-hmm.
Hawville is probably 60% Hispanic and so on. So he wanted to do the same thing for Hawville that he did for the Chatham Arch area with the Phoenix Theater when he bought the church there in order to help them. And so my current project, now that the Collaboration Center is set up, is to raise enough money to staff it, to have someone to develop the programs to enable the kids and others to participate at a very, very reasonable fee or at no charge if they can't afford it. And then to do some interior upgrades for the building.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my current interest.
That's fascinating. It just is interesting how philanthropy goes from, you know, lots of communities in the way that, I don't want to say recycle, but a way a lot of communities go through stages, and philanthropy helps sort of a regrowth of a community.
Yes.
And that's an example of it. So if there's someone who's coming up through the ranks who either hasn't thought about it or is considering it, who's wanting to go into philanthropy, what's wisdom would you have for that individual, you know, in terms of pathways of how they could become involved as a philanthropist? And perhaps if you'd have, we talked about philosophy already, what are some points of involvement or engagement? Do you have a list that you would have for engaging in such a project?
You know, I would say the first thing, because the philanthropy is primarily through not-for-profit organizations, is to select an organization that the potential philanthropist has an interest in, who has a similar, it has a similar vision of his. He agrees with the mission, because that's of utmost importance.
Yes.
If you don't really believe in it, you're not really going to become a part of it and want to serve it and want to contribute to it. So the first thing is to become involved in an organization that has, that coincides with that person's vision, and then to become active in it. And then as he accumulates money along the way, to begin contributing to it and helping it fulfill that vision and fulfill that mission. And you asked for a list. Actually, that's really what Katrina and I do when we're considering contributing to an organization. We take a look first at the vision, next at the mission. We look at the programs that they present. We look at the leadership of the organization in order to know that they're sustainable and that they're going to use the funds effectively that we're contributing to them. So the same things we look for is what I would suggest for a potential philanthropist to consider when they're looking at becoming involved in philanthropy with an organization.
Okay. That's very sound advice. Helping, you know, someone who would be considering that, because it's, isn't philanthropy, like you've said in your old story, you've kind of, it was along your pathway, it sort of found you.
Exactly.
And that happens to so many people, and I think a lot of people when they're starting out or they're more idealistic along their path, before they get into the nitty-gritty of life, you know, they might be thinking about thoughts of that, and they can plan for the future as they develop their wealth and their social involvement. Well, that's great. Lastly, are there any projects, you've mentioned Fonseca and the Center for the Performing Arts, we know that board, and the Heartland Film Festival. Are there any projects that you'd like to tell us about, of any of those organizations that are coming up?
You know, those are the primary ones that I'm working on now. Mm-hmm. And I will say that we've mainly talked about the arts and what we're doing in that. And that's my primary emphasis, partially because I'm not wealthy, so I had to focus on a particular area. So
sure.
It was the arts, and to a lesser extent, into the healthcare field through Eskenazi.
Yes.
And I'd like to maybe conclude with mentioning a couple of the programs there, which we've become involved with that have given us a lot of satisfaction and has fit into my mission. And one of them is the Greg Farabach Center for Empowerment. And we were one of the original lead donors for that because, again, it resonated with my mission. And its purpose is to enable Indiana college graduates with physical disabilities to obtain work in their chosen field,
mm-hmm.
and not having to go into some other field because they have a limitation. And these funds would help an employer and teach an employer that they can make minor modifications in the setup to enable mm-hmm. a person with a disability in order to function well.
That's great.
And I really have loved participation in that organization. And Greg Furbeck is the perfect person to have started that particular organization. And related both to arts and to healthcare, we also contribute to the Marianne Tobias Music Center at Eskenazi. There is a year-round programming in the lobby of Eskenazi for concerts and other arts events, primarily for the patients,
mm-hmm.
but also for their families and for visitors to come in and so on. And it's a great opportunity for all of them because increasingly we know what music and the arts can do for healthcare.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm really happy with that particular activity. Another one that we're involved with through Eskenazi is a fresh food place that's located in a pavilion that we sponsor there at Eskenazi that enables people at the hospital as well as surrounding areas in a relative food desert to have fresh food. Healthy food.
Oh, good.
And so on.
That's important.
Yes. And the final thing at Eskenazi is we sponsor a counseling center where people can come in and who don't have the means and so on in order to afford quality health care, in order to help them figure out how they can do that.
Mm-hmm.
And again, all of this fits in with my mission.
That's a great idea. I think that providing, because we all have our views on healthcare and all of that, but those elements really are helpful and would be helpful. And hopefully that'll take off and go all around the country because now I'm going to get political. The thing is that I've always thought there's all these things between private and social healthcare mm-hmm. that if the public, you had philanthropic involvement, like third party, that would help meet those needs, that could take care of the community, who need these elements mm-hmm. that you've talked about, that could really pick up the boat for a lot of people who are falling through the cracks. And, you know, healthcare is one of those things that it's very pricey, and healthcare is more than just getting a shot or a pill.
Yes.
It's what is going on in your life, and music, and having someone to be there for them, and all that care that's involved is quite significant. That's a great idea. I hope it thrives throughout the nation.
And you know, speaking of that, the Herron School of Art and Design also has a degree now in music therapy.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a place there which I'll mention called the Center for Art Design and Public Life, which is a part of Herron. And the purpose of this organization that we also sponsor is to export Herron's artistic talent and knowledge to the general community.
Mm-hmm.
A business or a government agency or a not-for-profit can contract with Herron to have an art piece made to their specifications or their requirements through this center, and a student under the supervision of a faculty member would actually construct that particular art piece.
Oh, wow.
And there was a competition, and once the specifications are given, three or four students might compete, mm-hmm, in order to get the commission to do that. And it's been a wonderful opportunity for these students to get work outside, to get a small commission, and also to have a great thing added to their resume, that they constructed a commissioned piece of art. And if you're familiar with the YMCA across from the Alexander Hotel downtown,
mm-hmm,
there's a huge sculpture above the entryway that was constructed through this center a student at Herron.
Wow.
So it really is fun to see all of these projects that are benefiting individuals and benefiting the community in general.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said before, not-for-profits do so much of this that governments don't do, perhaps could do. In fact, a lot of not-for-profits would not even be necessary if the government did some other things.
But, yeah, no, I hear that.
Yeah.
Although it's nice having that third party where it's the,
yes,
community, because the community is going to do a much better job than the government.
True.
And
that's true.
And that is where that, you know, people on the ground. For that's why we need more philanthropists. And so, but thank you so much for your thoughts on philanthropy and sharing with us today.
Well, thank you for inviting me to do so. Enjoyed it.
Thank you, Frank. We appreciate your time. And that is it for today's episode with Frank Basile. We would like to thank our sponsor, Hotel Carmichael. We're shooting today at Feinstein's. And we look forward to being with you on the next episode of The Omnibus Show.
If you enjoyed this program, please like, share, and subscribe to continue the conversation. For The Omnibus Show newsletter, please sign up at theomnibusshow.com.